It is said that a person's religion is felt more in the small events than in the big ones. It's there in the hugs and the glances. It's there in the moments when all else fades away and there is only love. In the rare and mystical sense of union with the depths of one's being. Our program looks back to tell the story of a woman. Through the poetry of the time come subtle glimpses into the strength, the joy, the hope, and above all, the faith, which were hers.
I will begin my story at the end of the Great War, May 1865, when I was 18 years old. I prided myself at that time as being a very well-educated and literate young lady, of good family and proper upbringing. It was important then to be well-versed in all of the fine arts, and remember well a recitation I gave from Lewis Carroll's new book, Alice's Adventures Underground.
You are old, Father William. You are old, Father William, the young man said, and your hair is exceedingly white, and yet you incessantly stand on your head. Do you think at your age it is right? In my youth, Father William replied to his son, I feared it might injure the brain. But now that I'm perfectly sure I have none, why, I do it again and again. You are old, said the youth, as I mentioned before, and have grown most uncommonly fat. Yet you turned a back somersault at the door. Pray, what is the reason for that? In my youth, said the sage, as he shook his gray locks, I kept all my limbs very supple. By the use of this ointment, 5 shillings a box. Allow me to sell you a couple. You are old, said the youth, and your jaws are too weak for anything tougher than suet. Yet you eat all the goose with the bones and the beak. Pray, how do you manage to do it? In my youth, said the old man, I took to the law and argued each case with my wife, and the muscular strength which it gave to my jaw has lasted the rest of my life. You are old, said the youth. One would hardly suppose that your eye was as steady as ever. Yet you balanced an eel on the end of your nose. What made you so awfully clever? I have answered 3 questions, and that is enough, said his father. Don't give yourself airs. Do you think I can listen all day to such stuff? Be off, or I'll kick you downstairs.
With my convent school days behind me, I have once again returned to live at home, and the spring of 1870 could never be better. There are many parties and church socials each month. I have several beaux who often call on me, and Father thinks that my thoughts should be concerned with getting married, but I'm having such a splendid time that I should like it never to end. I also have decided that I should only marry a truly noble man, as in the romance of the Swan's Nest, but I am not certain that there are many knights riding around today in April 1870. Little Ellie sits alone, mid the beaches of a meadow, by a stream side on the grass, and the trees are showering down doubles of their leaves in shadow on her shining hair and face. Little Ellie sits alone, and the smile she softly uses fills the silence like a speech. While she thinks what shall be done, and the sweetest pleasure chooses for her future within reach. Little Ellie in her smile chooses, I will have a lover riding on a steed of steeds. He shall love me without guile, and to him I will discover the swan's nest among the reeds. And the steed it shall be shod, all in silver, housed in azure, and the mane shall swim the wind, and hoofs along the sod shall flash onward and keep measure till the shepherds look behind. But my lover will not prize all the glory that he rides in when he gazes in my face. He will say, oh, love, thine eyes build the shrine my soul abides in, and I kneel here for thy grace. Then I, he shall kneel low with the red-roan steed near him, which shall seem to answer till I say, rise and go, for the world must love and fear him whom I gift with heart and hand. Then he will arise so pale, I shall feel my own lips tremble with a yes I must not say. Nathless maiden brave, farewell I will utter and dissemble, light tomorrow with today. Then he'll ride among the hills to the wide world past the river, there to put away all wrong, to make straight distorted wills, and to empty the broad quiver which the wicked bear along. three times, a young foot page will swim the stream and climb the mountain and kneel beside my feet. Lo, my master sends this gage, lady, for thy pity's counting. What wilt thou exchange for it? And the first time, I will send a rosebud for a guerdon, and the second time, a glove. And the third time, I may bend from my pride and answer, pardon, if he comes to take my love. Then the young footpage will run, then my lover will ride faster, till he kneeleth at my knee. I am a duke's oldest son. Thousand serfs do call me master, but, oh, love, I love but thee. He will kiss me on the mouth, and then lead me as a lover through the crowds that praise his deeds. And when soul-tied by one troth, unto him I will discover that swan's nest among the reeds. Little Ellie, with her smile not yet ended, rose up gaily, tied the bonnet, donned the shoe, and went homeward round a mile, just to see, as she did daily, what more eggs were with the two. Pushing through the elm tree copse, winding up the stream light-hearted, where the osier pathway leads, past the bough she stoops and stops. Lo, the wild swan had deserted, and a rat had gnawed the reeds. Ellie went home sad and slow, if she found that lover ever, with his red-roan steed of seeds. Sooth, I know not, but I know she never could show him never that swan's nest among the reeds.
Years have passed since girlhood days, and were there no calendar, I would still engrave upon my inmost heart, November 2nd, 1870, the day I met my glorious love. The autumn leaves were shades of crimson and gold, and the air was slightly chilly with the first frost of winter. It was a few words we spoke, but to gaze into his green eyes was to feel a sense of warmth and joy I had never known before. I hoped he would love me, and someday he would say that he did love me in many ways.
And my star. All that I know of a certain star is it can throw like the angled spar, now a dart of red, now a dart of blue, till my friends have said they would fain see too my star which dartles red and blue. That it stops like a bird, like a flower, hangs furled. They must solace themselves with the Saturn above it. What matter to me if their star is a world? Mine has opened its soul to me. Therefore, I love it.
I bound a rose in sheaves. Now, rose by rose, I strip the leaves and strew them where Pauline may pass. She will not turn aside. Alas, let them lie. Suppose they die. The chance was that they might take her eye. How many a month I strove to suit these stubborn fingers to the lute. Today I venture all I know. She will not hear my music. So break the string, fold music's wing. Suppose Pauline had bade me sing. My whole life long, I learn to love. This hour, my utmost art I prove and speak my passion, heaven or hell. She will not give me heaven? 'Tis well. Lose who may, I still can say, those who win heaven, blessed are they.
Beloved, my beloved, when I think that thou wast in the world a year ago, what time I sat alone here in the snow and saw no footprint, heard the silence sink no moment at thy voice, but link by link went counting all my chains, as if that so they never could fall off at any blow struck by thy possible hand. Why, thus I drink of life's great cup of wonder, wonderful, never to feel thee thrill the day or night with personal act or speech, or ever cull the blossoms white which thou sawst growing. Atheists are as dull who cannot guess God's presence out of sight.
All the breadth and the bloom of the year in the bag of one bee. all the wonder and wealth of the mine in the heart of one gem. In the core of one pearl, all the shade and all the shine of the sea. Breadth and bloom, shade and shine, wonder, wealth, and how far above them, truth. Truth that's brighter than gem. Trust that's purer than pearl. Brightest truth, purest trust in the universe. All were for me in the kiss of one girl.
First time he kissed me, he would only kiss the fingers of this hand wherein I write, and ever since it grew more clean and white, slow to world greetings, quick with its own list when the angels speak. A ring of amethyst I could not wear here plainer to my sight than that first kiss. The second passed in height the first and sought the forehead, and half missed, half falling on the hair. Oh, beyond mead, that was the chrism of love, which love's crown with sanctifying sweetness did precede. The third upon my lips was folded down in perfect purple state. Since when, indeed, I have been proud and said, my love, my own. Thou must love me, let it be for naught except for love's sake only. Do not say, I love her for her smile, her look, her way of speaking gently, for a trick of thought that falls in well with mine, and certes brought a sense of pleasant ease on such a day. For these things in themselves, beloved, may be changed, or change for thee, and love so wrought may be unwrought so. Neither love me for thine own dear pities wiping my tears dry. A creature might forget to weep who bore thy comfort long, and lose thy love thereby. But love me for love's sake, that evermore thou mayest love on through love's eternity.
Joyful day in June 1871, the most perfect day, with skies of blue and the arbor roses wafting sweetly in the breezes. I feel a sense of unbounded love in my heart, for today I marry the love of my life, for a lifetime which is far too short. It seems as though I have waited all of my life for this wonderful day, yet I'm a little frightened. Perhaps I'm too young to marry. What if my love is unkind? But he would never be unkind to me, for I am his darling.
How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. I love thee to the height and breadth and depth my soul can reach, when feeling out of sight for the ends of being and ideal grace. I love thee to the level of every day's most quiet need, by sun and candlelight. I love thee freely as men strive for right. I love thee purely as men turn from praise. I love thee with the passion put to use with my old griefs and with my childhood's fame. I love thee with the love I seem to lose with my lost saints. I love thee with the breath, smiles, tears of all my life. And if God choose, I shall but love thee better after death.
Well, it finally happened. Today is the wedding day, and who would ever think that I should be getting married? No more late evenings at the tavern playing cards. My lady will have none of that. She is a gentle soul, who speaks of summer on wintry days, and with a click of her heels and skirts in the breeze, she oft-time darts about in a whirlwind of joy. But mostly, it is the way she looks at me, which says, I love you. I would give up all I possess for that look, for dearest, I love you too. A heavy heart, beloved, have I borne from year to year until I saw your face, and sorrow after sorrow took the place of all those natural joys as lightly worn, as the stringed pearls, each lifted in its turn by a beating heart at dance time, hopes apace were changed to long despairs, till God's own grace could scarcely lift above the world forlorn my heavy heart. Then thou didst bid me bring, and let it drop down thy call me great deep being. Fast it sinketh, as a thing which its own nature doth precipitate,
while thine doth close above it, mediating betwixt the stars and the unaccomplished fate.
Several years of great happiness have been mine, and it seems that one spends most of it waiting on my love or on the next baby. I can scarcely believe that it's summer 1875, and with the family gathered close about, we are spending a typical Sunday afternoon. Most often on these summer days, we quite lazily read beneath the large oak tree in the yard, or more frequently, we join the children in their games and frolics on the lawn. Up into the cherry tree, who should climb but little me? I held the trunk with both my hands and looked abroad on foreign lands. I saw the next-door garden lie adorned with flowers before my eye, and many pleasant places more that I have never seen before. I saw the dimpling river pass and be the sky's blue looking-glass. The dusty roads go up and down with people tramping into town. If I could find a higher tree, farther and farther I could see to where the grown-up river slips into the sea, among the ships, to where the roads on either hand lead onward into fairyland, where all the children dine at five, and all the playthings come alive.
When children are playing alone on the green, in comes the playmate that never was seen. When children are happy and lonely and good, the friend of the children comes out of the wood. Nobody heard him and nobody saw. His is a picture you never could draw, but he's sure to be present abroad or at home when children are happy and playing alone. He lies in the laurels. He runs on the grass. He sings when you tinkle the musical glass. Whenever you are happy and cannot tell why, the friend of the children is sure to be by. He loves to be little. He hates to be big. 'Tis he that inhabits the caves that you dig. 'Tis he, when you play with your soldiers of tin, that sides with the Frenchman and never can win. 'Tis he, when at night you go off to your bed, bids you go to your sleep and not trouble your head. For whenever they're lying in cupboard or shelf, 'tis he will take care of your playthings himself.
The winter of 1875 is a hard one, and cold snows oft keep us indoors encircling the fireplace in the parlor. Most often, however, I am busy in the kitchen making fudge or beginning tomorrow's bread, while my darling husband is smoking his pipe and perusing the paper. The children, meantime, are busy planning how to get their father to read them a bedtime story, or attempting to figure out another way of convincing both of us that it is too early for them to go to bed. It is a pleasant sight to peek into the parlor and see the children gathered at their father's feet, gaily laughing.
The walrus and the carpenter. The sun was shining on the sea, shining with all his might. He did his very best to make the billows smooth and bright. And this was odd, because it was the middle of the night. The moon was shining sulkily, because she thought the sun had got no business to be there after the day was done. It's very rude of him, she said, to come and spoil the fun. The sea was wet as wet could be. The sands were dry as dry. You could not see a cloud because no cloud was in the sky. No birds were flying overhead. There were no birds to fly. The walrus and the carpenter were walking close at hand. They wept like anything to see such quantities of sand. If this were only cleared away, they said, it would be grand. If seven maids with seven mops swept it for half a year, do you suppose, the walrus said, that they could get it clear? I doubt it, said the carpenter, and shed a bitter tear. Oh, oysters, come and walk with us, the walrus did beseech. A pleasant walk, a pleasant talk, along the briny beach. We cannot do with more than four to give a hand to each. The eldest oyster looked at him, but never a word he said. The eldest oyster winked his eye and shook his heavy head, meaning to say he did not choose to leave the oyster bed. But four young oysters hurried up, all eager for the treat. Their coats were brushed, their faces washed, their shoes were clean and neat. And this was odd, because, you know, they hadn't any feet. Four other oysters followed them, and yet another four, and thick and fast they came at last, and more and more and more, all hopping through the frothy waves and scrambling to the shore. The walrus and the carpenter walked on a mile or so, and then they rested on a rock conveniently low, and all the little oysters stood and waited in a row. The time has come, the walrus said, to talk of many things, of shoes and ships and sealing wax, of cabbages and kings, and why the sea is boiling hot, and whether pigs have wings. But wait a bit, the oysters cried, before we have our chat, for some of us are out of breath, and all of us are fat. No hurry, said the carpenter. They thanked him much for that. A loaf of bread, the walrus said, is what we chiefly need. Pepper and vinegar besides are very good indeed. Now, if you're ready, oysters dear, we can begin to feed. But not on us, the oysters cried, turning a little blue. After such kindness, that would be a dismal thing to do. The night is fine, the walrus said. Do you admire the view? It was so kind of you to come, and you are very nice. The carpenter said nothing but cut us another slice. I wish you were not quite so deaf. I've had to ask you twice. It seems a shame, the walrus said, to play them such a trick. After we've brought them out so far and made them trot so quick. The carpenter said nothing but the butter spread too thick. I weep for you, the walrus said. I deeply sympathize. With sobs and tears, he sorted out those of the largest size, holding his pocket handkerchief streaming before his eyes. Oh, oysters, said the carpenter, you've had a pleasant run. Shall we be trotting home again? But answer there came none, and this was scarcely odd, because they'd eaten every one.
October 10th, 1885. Today my beloved joined his family and left his earthly home. I have decided to read again his letters to me.
My letters, all dead paper, mute and white, and yet they seem alive and quivering against my tremulous hands, which loose the string and let them drop on my knee tonight. This said he wished to have me once in his sight as a friend. This fixed a day in spring to come and touch my hand. A simple thing, yet I wept for it. This, the paper's light said, dear, I love thee. And I sank and I quailed as if God's future thundered on my past. This said, I am thine. And so its ink is paled with lying at my heart that beat too fast. Oh, and this, oh, love, thy words have ill availed. If what this said, I dared repeat at last.
I feel so lost, and such a void as nothing will ever fill it. It seems so unfair that he, a young, vital man of 43, should be struck dead with cholera. But I have always believed that God is just and shall dwell upon our happy moments together. as a fond mother, when the day is o'er, leads by the hand her little child to bed, half willing, half reluctant to be led, and leave his broken playthings on the floor, still gazing at them through the open door, nor wholly reassured and comforted by promises of others in their stead, which, though more splendid, may not please him more. So nature deals with us, and takes away our playthings one by one, and by the hand leads us to rest so gently that we go, scarce knowing if we wish to go or stay, being too full of sleep to understand how far the unknown transcends the what we know. Today is February 10th, 1890, and I have been alone 5 years now. The children are gone and grown, and it seems quite silent. Yet life is just turning through another cycle as fall begets winter, and winter begets spring. The world and I have changed somewhat over the past 25 years, but my heart and soul are still as lively as they were the day I married my dearest love. My life has been full of love and joy, without regrets. Could one ask for more?
Still, still with thee, when purple morning breaketh, when the bird waketh and the shadows flee, fairer than the morning, lovelier than the daylight, dawns the sweet consciousness I am with thee. Alone with thee amid the changing shadows, quiet the hush of nature newly born. Alone with thee in breathless adoration, in the calm dew and freshness of the morn. So shall it ever be in the bright morning, when hearts awakening see the shadows flee. Oh, in that hour, and fairer than the dawning, rises the glorious thought, I am with thee.